Reverend Colin Jones spoke to the City Club and the World Affairs Council from Cape Town, South Africa, gave us his perspective on events of the past and present there. Today we are honored to have one of the most knowledgeable persons in America on the state of affairs in South Africa, and certainly the person with the closest perspective on affairs in South Africa and how American policy may or may not be influencing those affairs. Edward Perkins is a career Foreign Service officer who was sworn in on November 3rd, 1986, as the United States Ambassador to the Republic of South Africa. Ambassador Perkins was born in Louisiana, but we can claim him now. He was raised here in Oregon. His mother still lives here. He maintains his legal address here in Oregon. He served in the Marine Corps for 4 years, received his bachelor's degree from the University of Maryland and his master's and doctorate degrees from the University of Southern California. Prior to joining the State Department, he served with the Agency for International Development in Bangkok, Thailand for a period. But since 1972, he has been with the State Department. He has served in a number of capacities there, mainly with reference to African and South Asian affairs. He served for several years in our embassies in Ghana and in Liberia, then was brought back to Washington, D.C. to be the director of the Office of West African Affairs in the State Department, where he served in that capacity for 2 years. In June of 1985, he was appointed ambassador to Liberia, where he remained until October 1986, and he assumed his present position as ambassador to South Africa last November. Please join me in welcoming Ambassador Edward Perkins.
Thank you very much for what I consider to be a very good welcome. It's good to be back in Portland, and it's good to be among people that you might call friends and colleagues. It's kind of nice to be here today with the City Club and with the Portland World Affairs Council to share with you a few thoughts about South Africa, which reflect in large measure my experience there for the past 7 months. I think the first thing I ought to tell you is that I'm no expert on South Africa. I really don't think I've got enough time left to serve there to really become an expert, frankly. Nevertheless, I'm pleased to try and share with you some thoughts which might help you to have a better understanding of what's happening there. I've been in South Africa, as I said, for about 7 months. Many of you may recall that when I was examined by the Senate in terms of my worthiness for this position, and when I was sworn in Washington, I said that I would try to get to understand South Africa in its historical context and in its contemporary context. And that meant getting to know South African people, getting into communities, and trying to understand it in the context of United States policy towards South Africa and our relations with that government. I've traveled to just about every point in South Africa since I've been there. I've met a lot of people, met a lot of black people, a lot of Indians, a lot of coloreds, which is a concept that some people find hard to accept, and a lot of Afrikaners and a lot of English speakers. I've talked to civil servants, to military people, to clergymen, and I've worshipped with many different parishes in South Africa. I met a lot of plain, ordinary people, like I am, in South Africa. Tried to get inside of them, to try and see what it is that makes them tick, but more especially, to understand their aspirations as an individual and as a member of that country. I would say that today I can't do any more than just give you a few impressions. About three suggest themselves to me this afternoon. The first is what's going on in South Africa. The second, what can we expect in the future, immediate future in South Africa? And very gingerly, perhaps a couple of thoughts on what we might be doing as a nation in South Africa. What's going on? A state of emergency has been in existence in South Africa for almost a year. It was recently renewed. That state of emergency has been pretty successful in restoring order, as the South African government likes to define it. It's been pretty rough. I would say that even though it has been successful, the aspirations of black South Africans have not been stilled. They may temporarily have been halted, but aspirations will not go back to pre-state of emergency levels. There have been a lot of detentions. Detentions of all kinds. Perhaps the most egregious is the detention of children. We've spoken out about that in South Africa. Recently, we had news that some have been released. My latest communication with the embassy fails to confirm exactly how many. We know that some have been released. Also, in this diaspora, labor is on the move. Black labor unions have taken on a role which is a little bit more than just a bargaining agent for a group of employees. It has, in my judgment, decided that it wants to be a part of nation building, the new South Africa of tomorrow. And then added to all of this was the election of May 6th of this year. In those elections, we saw a kind of shift to the right, dramatically, of the white voters. And we also find a kind of a realignment, if you will, of political forces in South Africa, white political forces. For example, the National Party won again. It has been in power for almost 40 years. And for the first time, voters did not return the Progressive Federal Party, the most liberal party, to the status of loyal opposition in the parliament. Instead, the Conservative Party won seats from both the nationalists as well as from the Progressive Federal Party. But in the main, the Progressive Federal Party lost voters to the National Party and the Herstukta National Party, which is the most extreme right-wing party, saw voters move leftward from that party to the National Party. Black politics is also in a kind of a dynamic phase, but blacks now feel a kind of a sullen despair that the results of the election indicate that white voters do not necessarily want any meaningful change. That means that blacks are reassessing their strategy. I think it's too early to tell what that strategy may be. But having said all that, I think I ought to tell you now that I find still an overwhelming number of blacks in South Africa who would like to find a different way to become a part of the governing process, to take on a part of the economic pie, and to be involved in the socialization program that is going on there. I think I probably ought to say something about sanctions. I don't think any talk like this would be complete unless I mentioned it. The first thing I ought to say is that the Comprehensive Anti-Apartheid Act of 1986, as a statement of abhorrence by the American people of a hated system, was an unmitigated success. There's no question about where the American people stand with respect to South Africa and its government at this time. Obviously, sanctions have not brought down the government. We don't know whether the government is affected by them or not. In short, it's too soon to tell. At this time, South Africa is at an impasse. I don't know how long that's going to last. Doesn't appear that to be that much dynamism in terms of the government looking for ways, innovative ways, to meet the demands of black South Africans to be a part of the governing process or to participate in determining how they're going to be governed. I might just say a few things about where South Africa seems to be going. I think that I want to tell you I'm reluctant to say it because every time somebody says something about South Africa in terms of what's going to happen, it goes off at a 20-degree angle and you have to go back and reassess yourself. But let me try. First, I think we can expect more authoritarianism in terms of how the government conducts its business. I think they'll be more responsive to things like labor unions, and maybe even to the funding of what the government refers to as extra parliamentary activities. In other words, funding that comes from offshore to activities in South Africa will probably be targeted somehow for scrutiny by the government. We don't know exactly how much. This drama, and it is a drama, fairly tragic one, has a long time to run. I don't know how long, I wish I did. But I'm sobered enough to know, as a result of having been there for a short time, that it has a lot of needles in it, and there's a lot of unsewed cloth that still has to be sewed and fashioned into something different than exists there now. The main forces in South Africa, as you may already have discerned, is an extreme contest between two nationalisms, black nationalism and Afrikaner nationalism. As I've said so often in South Africa, it's between blacks and whites. It is these two groups of people that will eventually determine whether South Africa really does turn into a Holocaust or by some enlightened method, a transition to a new South Africa is made. As far as the United States is concerned, I think that it is perhaps a bit much to think that we can determine a fashion, a political construct that will solve all the problems there. I think that has to be done by South Africans, black, white, colored and Indians, or what have you. However, having said that, I think that it is possible for the United States and other Western nations to facilitate maybe talks about talks. One of the most saddening things about South Africa is the lack of communication between blacks and whites. For 39 years, it's been legally permissible to keep these two groups of people apart. It's been very successful. In point of fact, in my judgment, blacks and whites don't know very much about each other. And you know from your own experiences that when there is a lack of communication, fear takes over. It can be more deadly than a bullet, and often is. A few words about perhaps what we should be doing as a nation. Obviously, from my view, any foreign policy worth its salt must be under constant review at all times. And of course, that should be true in this case. And that is happening. People who work with me and my embassy and myself are constantly analyzing, looking for ways to determine how we might best promote, first of all, our own national interest, and secondly, in recognition of the need to be in contact with that country over the long term. How best can we do that? It's a bleak picture that I'm painting to you, of course. I realize that. But I think that a bit of realism needs to be injected into the equation once in a while. I'm doing it today. New equations have been introduced by the elections. I think as a nation and as a government, we ought to keep a pretty close watch on what's happening in the southern region. The frontline states and the neighboring states of South Africa have a role to play in terms of inter-regional cooperation, economically, politically, and socially. Our watch needs to translate into economic activity. We need to enhance and facilitate and encourage intra-regional cooperation. We must also be aware that South Africa is very much interested in what happens in that region. There is a lot of dynamism going on as a country and as a people. We need to be aware of it. I think we need to look at more inventive ways to manage our relationship with the government of South Africa and with the South African people. We have to make it abundantly clear, in almost any way we can, our abhorrence of a system which has a minority of the population enjoying economic and political rights at the expense of a minority. And that function is a function of the American people. The concept of human rights, legal systems, a Bill of Rights is not the province of a Republican administration or a Democratic administration. It's the province of the American people. Our policy must reflect and manifest what we stand for as a nation. The Declaration of Independence, the Bill of Rights, subsequent amendments to the Constitution, and the revolutions that have occurred in this country, industrial, labor, equal rights, sexual rights, were not things that just happened. They reflect what we believe in as a people. Our policy must also reflect that in any way possible. We need to ask ourselves, is South Africa important to us as a nation? If, as I suspect, the answer is yes, it seems to me that dictates that we need to do something to sort of bet our coins on the future. There are a lot of ways to do that. I could stand here all day and give you academic suggestions. But let me leave with you today just two. First, I'd like to address education. Education is perhaps the most important ingredient, in my judgment, in a revolutionary struggle. Black South Africans will be managing South Africa sometime in the future. They will be managing government activities, and they will be managing corporate activities. There is a great need to provide education to black South Africans in this country. I think our country should be willing to provide in excess of 10,000 scholarships a year for black South Africans as change agents and as elements that will take over South Africa when the time comes and manage it responsibly so that South Africa joins the world of nations economically and politically could not be better done than by providing a lot of scholarships through responsible screening activities inside South Africa, headed by black South Africans, monitored by black South Africans, and when people return to South Africa, evaluated by black South Africans. The next one deals with business. I'm not one who believes that business should be the province of the elite. If there are any students of the Bible here today, you will know that commerce has always been a province of the people. We haven't packaged it very well as we seek to transport our commercial ideology to the various corners of the earth. As far as I'm concerned, it is a province of the people. If it is, then I offer this one for you. Without in any sense saying that American businesses ought to stay in South Africa or leave South Africa, let me say this. I would find it perhaps difficult to support a company remaining in South Africa if that company were not socially engaged in what's happening there. But when a company does leave, I think it ought to leave creatively. It ought to leave some of it there, either in the form of a trust, which could be used as capital for black South Africans to get a piece of the capital action, or to provide education to black entrepreneurs in the United States. So I offer those two things as an element of things that our country could be doing, and all the elements in our country. Finally, I might just give you a couple of thoughts about the U.S. mission. Headed by me, what will we be doing in the immediate future? We will continue to make contacts in all of the communities, more especially in the black communities and in the Africana communities. We'll continue to recommend ways that our government can creatively show its displeasure for that regime and for the practices it has in managing political, economic, and social rights. We will continue to use our aid program in creative ways to promote entrepreneurship, to try and deal with human rights activities, to provide some encouragement for legal representation for people who are incarcerated, and for people who need to find families, or whatever. We will continue to contribute to feeding programs so that people will get a balanced meal in many ways. We will continue to encourage those who are dealing with everyday activities in attempting to bring about a better life for all South Africans. I think that we must also do what we can to continue to manifest the outrage of the American people for that system. And we also will look for ways to try and facilitate the merging of political and economic progress together. Often, in my experience, economic activities sometimes can bridge the gap where political activities cannot, even in this country. This is not heroic that I've explained to you this morning. It's not dramatic. It's kind of realistic. When the kaleidoscope finally plays itself out, the kind of models that we are dealing with here, I hope, will let us know who the players are on the other side of the river, and hopefully have some influence on helping them to manage their country in a responsible way so that there can be cooperation far and wide of one of the most beautiful countries in the world with tremendous resources, with extraordinary people, which has the potential of making come true all the dreams that we as Americans tend to feel is embodied in our own history. There, all the ingredients are there. We just need someone to cook the cake. On that note, I think I'll close.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. We now have time for some questions. As I said at the beginning, there are forms on the table for those of you who would like to write out a question, and people will be circulating to bring them up here to the podium. There'll be a microphone set up in a moment there for those of you who'd like to address your question personally to the Ambassador. But our first question is from our host today, James Stewart.
I want to thank you, Ambassador, particularly for a very, very thoughtful talk this morning, not only thoughtful, but thought-provoking. I understand that there has been a Senate bill made into law not too long ago that punishes Southern African states like Mozambique, Zimbabwe, Zambia, Botswana, which harbor South African blacks. It seems to me that that puts us squarely on the wrong side, if you will, of the struggle for democracy in South Africa. Would you comment, please?
You know how to start out, don't you? Well, I think you're probably referring to an amendment which was introduced recently. I understand from my desk people in the State Department that drama has not yet played itself out and that there are efforts to try and change that. The position of the government of the United States is that it is not something we'd like to see be enacted into law.
Yes, sir.
Bill Weber, member. Your presentation was very moving to me, and I can say that I'm deeply appreciative of the fact that you are my ambassador in South Africa. My question has to do with those of us over an extended period of years representing individuals, ourselves, and institutions have had to face the question of divesting of investments in South Africa. I know you've touched on that to some degree, and I'd like to ask you if you could explore that a little bit further from the standpoint that those of us who have had a sincere interest in benefiting the people of South Africa and trying to effect constructive change, avoiding violence if possible, have relied upon the Sullivan principles. Recently, Dr. Sullivan didn't retire from those principles, but he departed from that as an effective form of action, in my opinion. But at the same time, knowing some of the companies personally that are involved in South Africa, I was hopeful that the mere fact those companies were there treating people in South Africa the same way they treat people in Oregon could be an effective step towards better understanding among blacks and whites in South Africa. And my question is, would you care to comment further about that matter?
I don't think no is in my lexicon as far as that question is concerned. I'll say a couple of words about it. Obviously, Reverend Sullivan agonized a great deal over his decision. Those of us who have such tremendous respect for him met with him last month. And while he didn't tell us what he was going to do, We were all impressed with the tremendous integrity that this man has. I don't think he would disagree with anything I'm going to say now. First of all, I would say that American corporate structures in South Africa who adhered to the Sullivan principles have performed a service, perhaps unmatched in history in this context. The question of whether they could do more is always an open one. I come from the view of saying you can always do more. Well, I think that's what you depend on as a means of developing a paradigm of personal performance. I'd like to go back to what I said before. First of all, divestment as a theological issue is far beyond my capability to address. But I can address what individuals and companies can do in a situation to change some of the social concepts and political concepts that black people must live and operate under. But that's not enough. For as long as any black person or other person is subjugated or in jail or forced to live in a place where they don't want to live or should not have to live, it's not enough. I don't urge companies to leave or stay. I just urge that we adhere to the principle that if you're in a place, you're making money, you incur social obligations in this country as well as in South Africa. And therefore, I just urge when divestment takes place, it'd be done creatively. If you have a university with $1 billion or more in investments in company XYZ and that company wants to pull out, it shouldn't be too much to ask the university to think about leaving its money in a trust, which can help other South Africans who are subject to the violations of apartheid. Reverend Sullivan has indicated that he did reach his decision after much anguish. I think he's very much appreciative of what the companies did. Although he hasn't said so, I'm sure he would be the first to say that if you must stay, if you do stay, and don't pull out in 9 months, as he suggests, then he would like for them to be creative and to adhere to the Sullivan principles. I think that's about all I can say about that.
Thank you.
Ambassador, you mentioned the recent elections in South Africa and the shift, perhaps from both sides, toward the Nationalist Party. What is the extent of white opposition now to apartheid in South Africa, or is there any left?
There's some left. There's a great deal left, actually. There are two things that amaze me in South Africa. The first is that there's still so much goodwill left among blacks towards whites in South Africa. And that there are a lot of South Africans, Afrikaners included, who want to see South Africa changed. I might mention two or three things which signal some change, signal some thinking on that. One is the stand taken by the Dutch Reformed Church last November in Cape Town at its annual synod, where a manifesto was issued which said that apartheid can no longer be supported by Christian principles. This is a very dynamic change in the church. The other are the independents and the Stellenbosch professors who broke away from the National Party before the election. I think that you might see some political realignment somewhere in South Africa, which may signal a different way of looking at things. The question is there enough time, and how long can a country remain 5 minutes to midnight?
Yes, my name is Basco County, member City Club. Mr. Ambassador, I'm not ashamed, but I'm surprised that you, as an African American, and coming to talk to us tonight, this afternoon, has not taken the occasion to say something about Sithole and some of the other leaders who have been imprisoned in South Africa for the past 25 years. And secondly, my other question is, what is your comment about Chief Buthelezi vis-a-vis the African National Congress with regards to their quest for independence or participation in the government?
Thank you. I probably ought to mention Chief Buthelezi first. From my adventure in my view in South Africa, he is a controversial figure. There are those who say he's collaborated. There are those who say he has blood on his hands. And then there are those who say that he's a genuine leader of the Zulu people. I don't think I'm in a position to pass a value judgment one way or another on that. Let me move on to the people who've been jailed for 26 years. It's true that perhaps one of the most egregious things we can think of is the jailing of Nelson Mandela and his colleagues for 26 years. And to see their wives go and visit them when they have an opportunity with as much enthusiasm as they must have had when they first went on the first date. First of all, it's very humbling, and secondly, it's very heartening. It's a position of, certainly a position of our government, and it is the active position of my embassy that we push in any way we can for the release of these people, and we'll continue to do that.
Thank you very much.
This may be related, Ambassador. In view of American support by our government to the white South African government and to rebels in Angola and Mozambique who support the white South African government and are opposed to the black governments there, how can we, or how can you as our ambassador, give or communicate an unambiguous position of abhorrence to apartheid in view of our double standard?
Well, I know what I stand for as the ambassador. I know what our country stands for. And I know what my instructions are, and they are to represent the American people and the American government to South African people and to the South African government. And each time that I talk and communicate that, it will be a strong, unambiguous stand on behalf of all the American people. I've done that since I've been there. No one has said stop doing it. I'll continue to do it.
Sir, Ralph Crawshaw, City Club member. I'd like you to reflect, if you would, as an educator more than a diplomat, about academic sanctions. Academic sanctions which are punishing the anti-apartheid people within South Africa. For example, the fact that the Scandinavian countries will no longer publish any scientific material generated by scholars in South Africa. For example, Philip Tobias, an outstanding anthropologist anatomist professor at Witwatersrand in Johannesburg, is not allowed to go to meetings in Great Britain. For example, here in Portland, Portland State University invited Anna Feinenauer to be a teacher at our university and then has barred her from coming and participating in the summer sessions on the grounds that they cannot guarantee her safety.
I think I would answer that by simply saying that another thing I find very surprising in South Africa is how little is known about the outside world. Without in any sense saying that there should be a policy of boycotting or non-boycotting, I would simply say that whatever medium can be used to bring together South Africans with outsiders who may be able to influence our way of thinking, our way of doing business, should not be discarded. I would go one step further and say that Black South Africans also need the opportunity of communicating and of hobnobbing, if you will, to use the street language, with people in all countries of the West. And so if you have a medical association, a lawyers group, a political science association, public administration association, all of these are within my own model for bringing about the opportunity for people to talk to each other and exchange views and ideas, which are, in essence, against the system of apartheid. So I think that's the way I'd answer that.
The Black community in South Africa is, in fact, a number of different communities. Will tribal differences hamper the Black people of South Africa in their effort to press for participation in government there?
No.
Mr. Ambassador, my name is Avelle Gordley. I'm with American Friends Service Committee. You said in your remarks that the U.S. government should promote intra-regional economic activity. Could you be specific and outline what exactly the American government is prepared to do in order to achieve this?
The United States, has a program which cooperates with the South African Development Corporation. SADC, as it is known. We have a bill in Congress which seeks to have several million dollars allocated to that, which will touch upon transportation mainly, which is one of the more critical areas in that area, movement of goods and services to railheads and to ports, and some health delivery systems as well. That's still being debated in the Congress. I can't tell you how much money is being going to be allocated if it's passed, but let me just say that it is a cooperative effort with the Western European nations and Japan. Probably one of the most innovative and creative ways of using economic assistance that has been devised since 1947.
Thank you.
How influential is Archbishop Tutu in South Africa? Do Blacks pay any attention to what he says?
Well, the answer is yes, Blacks do pay attention to what he says. I don't know how influential he is. I would say he's a leading spokesperson. He's a theologian of some note. And he is now pastor of one of the largest Anglican churches in South Africa. Just by definition, he has some influence.
Carolyn M. Leonard, member of City Club. I'm here to raise a question, but I'd like to frame it just briefly. We have brought six students out of 150 that participated in a conference on South Africa in Portland Public Schools. These students, who are high school students, are extremely concerned about South Africa and have generated a question, and I'd like, if you would, for you to consider it and give your answer. As a representative of a country who is obviously against apartheid, how do you plan to convey our message to the white Afrikaners instead of worrying how to make harmony between our countries? Shouldn't you be worried about what you plan to do for the black South Africans? Please consider this is a question from high school students that are looking for answers and ways to pursue their own.
That's it.
Yes.
Thank you. Well, the first part of the question asks whether or not we should be looking at more creative ways of doing our business there. And the answer is, of course we should. And shouldn't we be worrying about harmony, I assume harmony between our two governments? That's not an issue with us. We're not looking at that.
One, looking excuse me,
go
just
ahead.
One part of the question. I think their concern is, how do you plan, or is there a plan, do you have a plan to convey our country's message about how we feel about South Africa and what's going on?
Yes, the plan calls for us to do it every day.
Could you?
Any way that we can.
Could you give us an example of how that
might
happen?
Sure. When I meet with the foreign minister and convey to him our desire that Nelson Mandela is released, or that Walter Sisulu be released, it's always accompanied by a statement of what the American people believe with respect to what's happening in South Africa. Not only that, me and people of my embassies travel all over South Africa. The purpose of traveling is to do two things. One is to get to know as many South Africans as possible, to see them in their own habitat, and to let them know and to manifest what the American people believe and feel. We will continue to do that.
Thank you very much.
Ambassador, what are the national interests of the United States in South Africa?
Essentially, it's a regional one, dealing with economic activity, and I suppose some political activity as well, security concerns. I think most of it is, in the long term, would be economic activity. We believe that as long as there is economic cooperation, there's less of an opportunity for political conflagrations which might develop into full-scale war, I guess. So we're basing most of what we do on economic activity, economic cooperation.
We have time for one last question, sir.
Your Honor, I would like to express my concern for black people. You speak of this issue as a black and white thing in South Africa. I understand the United States has a mutual defense agreement with South Africa committing our military in support of the apartheid regime. Is this correct?
It is not correct.
Okay, do we have any military obligation to South Africa?
None.
Okay. Are we lending any military support to the black nationalist movement?
None that I know of in South Africa.
Would you encourage the United States military to support the democratic move of South Africa?
I think I probably ought to defer on that.
Thank you.
Ambassador, we are very honored by your presence here today, and we admire you for standing up here and taking these very difficult questions and answering them so eloquently. Thank you very much for being with us today. And we appreciate all of you coming, and we are adjourned. Thank you.